Right, so welcome to our next interaction meeting, which is on undefined behavior, both in the source language and the IR. Over to you, Setu.
So hi everyone. So today we're going to talk about undefined behavior. So we're going to cover what is undefined behavior, how does it interact with the compiler in terms of optimizations, do we want it, do we not want it, and if we want it, under what conditions do we want it. We are also going to talk about poison values. So poison values allow us to do certain optimizations. We're going to talk about them, we're going to talk about the semantics, and at the end we are going to wrap it up by talking about deferred and immediate undefined behavior. So let's get started. So the first module is undefined behavior semantics. So first of all, what is undefined behavior? So well, certain statements might be logically not well defined. For instance, if I divide by zero, what is the answer? Well, it depends, right? I mean, there is no explicit definition for it. So from a language designer point of view, you have two options. Either you leave it as it is and you say that if you divide by zero, you're totally on you. It's not my issue. And if you do such things, I can do whatever I want with it. So that would be undefined behavior. This is something what C++ does. So if you divide by zero, well, the exact what would happen is implementation dependent. It is hardware dependent, but the language does not give you any guarantees. On the other hand, you may actually try to explicitly capture this behavior by maybe throwing an exception. So for instance, your language semantics might say that if you do a divide by zero, you're going to get an exception. So there are two options with us. Either we explicitly define it or we leave it undefined. So when we leave it undefined, then we call it undefined behavior. So what happens if we leave it undefined? Well, the code will behave differently on different machines. Well, the thing is that the language does not guarantee how the code is going to behave, right? The exact implementation will decide how the code is going to behave. So for instance, the compiler may leave it up to the assembler and say that, okay, it's not my problem. It's going to emit an instruction which does a divide by zero, and I'm going to leave it up to the assembler to do whatever it may want with it. The assembler might even leave it up to the hardware and say that, okay, I'm just going to generate an opcode for it, and now the hardware might do whatever it wants with it. And the hardware may, you know, maybe it causes a crash, it causes an exception or whatever it is. But the thing is that it's not well defined. If the code runs a certain way on my machine, it might run very differently on your machine. Well, because it's undefined, right? So for instance, the hardware may crash the machine if such behavior is triggered. The hardware may simply ignore this instruction. This is also a valid thing, right? So if you seize them, these illegal instructions in some sense, then you simply ignore them. So now let's talk about what is the cost of handling. So clearly we may not want actually to have this undefined behavior because it becomes very difficult to code in this way, because you not really know how your code is going to behave. So how do you handle it? So for example, in languages like Java and Python, what you can do is you can dynamically add checks around these statements, which might generate undefined behavior. So of course, this is obviously going to come with 3-4 lines of instructions for every aspect. And this is a cost which some languages think that it's fine to pay, and other languages say that it's not justified. So it's totally dependent on what's the language philosophy. For instance, Python and Java might say that, okay, it's something which we would like to capture, but C++, which is very performance oriented, they might say, okay, maybe we don't want to capture this. We trust the programmer to not make such mistakes. And of course, if some of these undefined behavior is passed through the compiler, this may lead to security vulnerabilities. For instance, a big class of attacks against programs is the buffer overflow attack. So what buffer overflow lets you do is it actually writes you right out of your program, out of your function stack. So typically this should not be allowed, right? But C++ would not check it, right? If you can somehow overflow the buffer, you can cross, you can write through your stack. In that case, well, you might actually take control over the program, right? So let's see how we can exploit buffer overflows from a compiler's point of view, from an optimization. So do you think this code is legal? Well, think about what if n is int-max. In this side of the code, int-max plus 1 is actually going to be 0. And whereas in this side of code, n would still be int-max. So this side of code was not going to be done. Maybe it won't run even once, whereas this would run int-max number of times. So as I said, that if n is int-max, we have wraparound, and we have wraparound semantics. So the wraparound semantics means that if you reach the higher level, if you reach that maximum value of a variable, then you loop back to the minimum value. So if you reach int-max, then you're going to go to the minus int-max, right? Int-max. So in this case, the transformation is illegal as both the pieces of code do different things. So what if we have signed overflow works undefined behavior? So in this case, the compiler can say, well, I do not expect n plus 1 to overflow because I trust the programmer to not give me such code, right? I trust the programmer to not actually explicitly add undefined behavior in the code. And if he or she does, well, then he or she is on its own. So I don't care about in that case. Either way, I can do this transformation. And now we can actually remove this n plus 1 addition in every iteration. And we can do this optimization. So we can see that undefined behavior actually allows us to do some optimization. Another example is simultaneousing. So now we have two arrays, one is of int, one is of float, and then we're doing some operation on them. And we can see that we are accessing this array A in every iteration of the inner loop. So what we can do is we can just hoist it out and call it locally. So we can actually, instead of doing memory dereference each and every time, we can just do it once and then we can use the local variable. And this local variable can be register allocated. So this would not be legal because what happens if A and B overlap? If certain elements of A actually overlap with B, well, then what can happen is that B of I might actually start altering A, right? So, however, with undefined behavior semantics, if we see that if we have a piece of memory, it cannot be both int and float together. Under those semantics, we can actually do this transformation. Because if they were to overlap, then that would be undefined behavior, right? As you said, compiler does not care what happens in undefined behavior, so it is perfectly valid to do this optimization if we assume that a particular memory cannot be typecasted by two different variables. So this is called type-based strict aliasing. So if you assume that type-based strict aliasing exists and violating it would be undefined behavior, in that case, this is a valid transformation. Let's see a third example.
In the previous example, actually somebody pointed this out to me on the YouTube channel that this transformation is legal only if you know that it is okay to dereference A. You know, because if n was 0 and A was, let's say, null, then this transformation would be illegal. I just want to point that out.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that is definitely. So, but null pointer dereference, are they also undefined behavior, or does C++ explicitly say that you cannot dereference a null pointer? Would that also be undefined, no?
Null pointer dereference is also undefined behavior, yes.
Yeah, so in that case, it would be legal anyways, right? A or B could be any random value, right?
I'm saying that you see, in this transformation, star A is getting hoisted. The computation star is getting hoisted. And that is, you know, that's acceptable only if star A was not going to cause UB.
Yeah. Oh, right. Yes.
So this transformation is not legal, strictly speaking, unless the compiler has some way of figuring out that star A is not going to cause UB.
Yes.
Because, pointed out by somebody on the YouTube channel. Yeah, thanks.
Thank you for clarifying that. So the third example is based variables. So again, what if n is more than 257 and A 256 aliases with B? So maybe they are laid contiguously in the memory. And so one element passed A would now end up at B. So of course, in this case, this transformation would be illegal because now you would actually end up modifying B, right? So hoisting this B of 0 out would not be legal because, you know, in some iteration, you may be modified B of 0. And for the subsequent iteration, then you would be using the updated value. So hoisting this local B out of this loop and register allocating it would not be legal. So, but again, if you assume that, you know, accessing out of bounds elements of A is undefined behavior, well, in that case, it's this is a legal thing. So basically what you can see that P never goes out of it. P is a pointer, it starts at the first element of A and then you loop through it. So if you assume that P will never actually go out of A, and if it does, it's undefined behavior. In that case, it is a legal transformation because the compiler can say that, okay, as long as P stays within A, I can prove that this is a valid transformation, and if it goes out of A, well, then there are no guarantees anyway. So I can anyways do it, right? These are the three examples of undefined behavior and how they can help us in improving the optimizations. So how do we capture this undefined behavior in LVM is the next question. So for instance, what you can do is you can have different flavors of a certain instruction, which show undefined behavior on different cases. And why would you want to do this? Because LLVM LLVM sits between a front end, right? So front end might actually take different languages. It might take C++, it might take Java or something. In that case, you actually want your IA to actually capture all these different behavior, regardless of whatever source language you are working with. So clearly, just sticking with C++ semantics is not going to cut it. So for instance, LLVM can actually have different instructions. For instance, we have different instances of add instruction here. So in this particular type of add, we have undefined behavior if you have signed overflow, and in this case, we have undefined behavior if you have unsigned overflow. So some instructions can have multiple flavors to handle different UD semantics. So this is just to make sure that the IO is compatible with different principles. Right? So let's move to the next module. This is undefined behavior in the IO. So UBeam sources usually provides opportunity for optimizations, and UBeam target might cause problems. Why it might cause problems? Because we do not want to add more undefined behavior, because that would be not correct. If my programmer assumes, and if my programmer's program guarantees that there's not going to be undefined behavior, we cannot just add an undefined behavior, because that's going to make our program not firm. Right? So let's take an example of this. So let's say we have this kind of code. So suppose C is false. So in this particular case, this statement is never executed. And even if X plus 1 triggers some undefined behavior, it's perfectly fine. Right? If a programmer can somehow guarantee that C is always false, in that case, this is a this code is fine. But if you hoist this y is equal to x plus 1 out of this if condition, well, in that case, this transformation becomes invalid, because even if C is false, in this case, x plus 1 will always get triggered, right? And as you can see, in this case, we have a phi node. So even if y is equal to x plus 1, and if C is false, then this is not going to be used, right? I'm going to pick this particular value, right? So whereas in this particular case, whether C is false or not, x plus 1 is always triggered. So in this case, this would be an invalid transformation, because what if X is uint max and causes an undefined behavior and C is false? So in this case, left never triggers UB, but right always does. So again, UB may limit optimizations. So as we saw that in this particular case, because of UB, we could not hoist this out. Similarly, we have a case of loop as well. Again, we have similar kind of thing. Y equal to X plus 1, we are doing it in a loop. We cannot hoist it out, because what if the loop programmer guarantees that the loop is never going to get executed, whereas in our case, regardless of whether the loop is executed or not, we are going to execute X plus 1. So invalid as right always triggers UB, whereas left only triggers UB if the while condition is true. So UBeam source enables optimization, UBeam target hinders optimization, right? So ideally, source has a lot of UB, so there's a lot of opportunity for optimization. But we don't want any UB in the target, right? Because that's going to make our transformations invalid. And so the IA designer has to find a middle ground between, because compiler transformations, the source and the target is actually the IA only, right? So you take an IA, you put some optimizations to it, and you pass it on to the next optimization. The source and the target is going to be the same IA. So an IA designer has to be careful that what exactly causes UB in IA and what doesn't. Because if there is a lot of UB, then the target will hinder the thing, right? And if there is very little UB, then the source will hinder optimization. So we have to be very careful about it, right? So one way to deal with this is poison values, which is the topic of our next module. So what are poison values semantics? Well, so we saw an example when y is equal to x plus 1, hoisting it out of the loop was an undefined behavior, which caused the optimization to become invalid. Well, what if we can say that, okay, maybe if I'm never using y, then it is valid, right? Truly right. If C was in that example true, and I was never using y is equal to x plus 1, so it was technically valid because I was never using an invalid one. This is what poison value semantics does. So what exactly it is? So when we have UB, anything can happen, right? Out of these possibilities, we generate a possibility of generating an erroneous value. We call this value or a poison value. So for instance, if x is equal to a plus b and the addition overflows, instead of simply classifying this statement as UB, we can simply say that the value in x is erroneous value. And you know, if you try to use that value, maybe that will cause some issue. But as it is, if this statement exists in the code and x is never used erroneously, in that case it is fine. Right. So let's go back to our example. So in this case, y is assigned a positive value, but since y is never used again, this is a valid transformation, right? Even if I add some erroneous value to y and I never use it again, it's fine, right? And under poison value overflow semantics, this is valid. Again, another example, y is equal to x plus 1. So what if c is equal to false? Well, if c is equal to false, I take the y value from here, right? And if c is equal to false, so I generate y1, and if c is equal to false, this condition is going to be true. and I'm going to take this y2. So in regardless of both, in both the cases, I never use expression value, right? So now the question becomes, what happens when you do an operation on Poisson value? For instance, if y was a Poisson value in this case, y is equal to x plus 1, maybe x overflowed. So y is a Poisson value, what happens? All right, okay. So we have seen that how Poisson value helps. So again, as I said that, so if c is false, then anyways, I'm going to pick this particular value, so it's perfectly fine. And the next question is, what happens if I do an operation on Poisson value? Well, option one is that doing an operation in Poisson value triggers an UV. So in this case, what happens is that z is equal to y by 2 is going to trigger a UV, and this again becomes invalid. The transformation becomes invalid. So again, no, z is equal to y by 2, which triggers UV. Other option is that any operation in Poisson value also results in Poisson value. So in this particular case, z would also simply become a Poisson value, and this would be still be a valid transformation as long as z is never used during this case. So target returns Poisson in z, which is never used. So what's the solution? Well, if x1, op, x2 may generate a Poisson value, if any of the arguments is a Poisson value. And a Poisson value, and the reason we call it a Poisson value, because the Poisson value poisons the rest of the computation. Right? And now the question is, should we allow this kind of transformation? So notice that instead of y by 2, no, we have 2 by y. The problem with this kind of optimizations is that divide by 0 is almost always hardware dictated that it was actually going to generate exactly. So in this case, if y is equal to is a Poisson value, 2 by y is actually a dangerous operation. Why? Because 2 by y will actually cause hardware to generate a divide by 0. Right? So we do not want this kind of transformations to be valid. So clearly, simply saying that any operation on Poisson value generates a Poisson value is not the correct answer. We need to be very careful about that. So why did this happen? Why was this transformation invalid? Divide by 0 is more dangerous than other operations. If we hash it out, the program may terminate because of hardware semantics. Therefore, in some cases, Poisson value to trigger UV, and some cases we do not. So, for instance, if we are doing x is x by Poisson, we want to trigger UV, and if you're doing Poisson by x, we do not want to trigger UV. Right. So now we're going to talk about what should be the exact Poisson value semantics and how we can capture this in a more formal way. The guiding principle is that again, if a Poisson value exists, it's totally up to us what we want to do. But still, we want to have semantics that it allows us for maximum optimization. So let's say we have these kind of different instructions here. So again, so these all might actually not generate, right? Because and again, we have different choices for semantics here, right? You might see that if we are ending a Poisson value with 0, then we should always get 0, right? We can make an argument that ending anything with 0 will give me 0. Or maybe if I'm doing or with 1, then the LSD would always be 1. We can make this kind of semantics, but again, you will see that Poisson values are actually much more flexible. You can cast a Poisson value to a constant whenever you want, right? Because again, it's a Poisson value, it can be anything. But we cannot go back from a constant to a Poisson value. So it's always better to have a Poisson value with you and use it whenever you want as a constant, but not the other way around, right? So all of these written Poisson value are ending with Poisson with 0 could actually restrict that thing, right? So Poisson value is almost always more flexible. So now let's talk about another class of instructions, the branch instructions. So what happens if we have a branch in Poisson value? So we can see that the if condition is dictated by a Poisson value. And to put it in context, and for instance, the code could look something like this: if x is sync max and y is equal to x plus 1, and we are doing y is equal to 10. So again, y is a Poisson value, so this comparison would again be a Poisson value, right? So this comparison returns a Boolean value by using double equals to operator. And again, that could be a Poisson value. Right. So we have different options for us. One is that we can deterministically, non-deterministically choose any of the branches. We can say, well, it's a Poisson value. We can choose either if condition or the else condition. Other thing is that maybe we can just say the whole if else condition is no op, right? But then that might not make all the logical sense because if else condition might have different instructions. Other thing is that if we have some other information available from other parties, maybe we know that x will either be 0 or Poisson, something like that, so then we can make some more informed decisions. But clearly, there is no clear benefit of doing any of these. So LVM takes the easy way out and says that, okay, if you are doing branching on a Poisson value, then it's an undefined behavior, and you simply mark it as a not reachable. Right. So what you do is you say that if you have this kind of semantics, if you are doing branching on Poisson value, we simply mark it as unreachable. So unreachable is an instruction in LVM which says that if you reach this, you should not reach this statement at all. Right. So but then again, whenever we cast a poison value to undefined behavior will lose certain optimizations because now we cannot use that poison value in a target. Right? Why? So for instance, one example is this. If B was actually undefined, right, we cannot do this transformation. Right? So because if B is a poison value, then this whole condition would then become illegal, right? So as we were comparing with A, right? Maybe this the inner if would have become undefined. But in this case, the whole if condition becomes undefined. So this is clearly not valid. And we cannot do this transformation just because you said that, you know, branching on a poison value makes the whole thing untrue. And again, we can see another example over here that, you know, if D was poison and C is false, then again, in the original source code, we are never going to execute this if condition. This is fine. But if we hoist this out of this loop, then this piece of code becomes unreachable and now it comes in the code path, right? We cannot do that. That's illegal. So that was one class of instructions. Let's talk about another class, which is memory accesses. So if the address is a poison value, then that is a big problem. Whereas if the data is a poison value, it's perfectly fine, right? If the data is a poison value, when we store a poison value, and when we read back from that address, we can simply say that we got back the poison value. So if in the address X, we wrote some poison value, and when we dereference it and get the data back, we can simply say that Y now also has a poison value. Whereas if the address itself becomes poison, then that's a problem because you don't exactly know where you are storing the data, right? So every time we find a poison value as UD, we use the optimization opportunities. So for instance, if an instruction triggers UD, it cannot be hoisted out of the loop, right? And so some opcodes have constrained motion. By constrained motion, I mean that they cannot be moved around arbitrarily because they can cause UD. Where other can move because only thing they're going to do is they're going to generate poison value. So another thing, as I pointed out earlier, you can always convert a poison value to a constant if you want, but you cannot go the other way around. So it's always good to determine the poison value, because for all you get, the poison value could be anything, right? So it's always valid transformation to convert a poison value to a constant. Right, so this means this is the last module. This is immediate versus deferred UD, which is another way to classify UD. So let's pick up some examples. So let's say Y is equal to int max plus 1. In C, this will immediately trigger UD, right? But in LLVM, we can start looking for optimization. We can just assign it to a poison value, and then we will see if you want to use it, right? Again, if Y is equal to X by 0, again, we discussed this in the dangerous operation. So in this case, both C and LLVM, both will generate immediate UD. If we do X plus poison value, well, in LLVM, we can again generate a poison value. And if we have a branching on poison value in C and LLVM, both we will see that this is an immediate UD. So immediate UD is something that you immediately see that this is undefined behavior and this is not something I'm going to allow. And poison value say that, okay, maybe I'm going to assign an erroneous value right now. And maybe if later I do not use it, I do not use it. It's fine. But if I use it later in dangerous way, then I will see that it's an immediate UD. Right? So if the poison value is never used in a dangerous situation, we can avoid the UD. Therefore, poison value is a form of dereferred UD. So the UD was deferred to a future instruction. Right. So that covers the slides. So yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Sergio, for that nice summary. Yeah, that was very helpful. So yeah, let's open the floor for questions. Jay.
Hi everyone. So we saw a few examples where we performed loop invariant code motion and discussed whether we can hoist the value up or not. And we cannot hoist the value if there's UB in the target language, right? So my question is that, and also with reference to the example that you told that someone commented on in the channel. So if this is exactly the loop invariant code motion that we saw, we cannot hoist it anywhere unless we invert the loop, right? So if we invert the loop first, and then we won't have any of these issues, right?
All right, sure. Yeah, I mean, if you invert the loop first, then it becomes, then some of these transformations become possible. Yeah, that's
because I mean, we cannot, if we don't invert it, then we hoist a statement that may never be executed.
Right.
So that violates.
Right. Yes, I mean, just to be, you know, just to bring clarity to the discussion, I think what you're saying is that if you have, let's say, while C and some body B, you instead change it to if C and then do while. So do B and then while C, right? So that's loop inversion. And in that way, what happens is you do an explicit check on C upfront using if. And then once you do that, then you, you know, then the basic, recall that loop inversion is a form of loop peeling. So in a sense that you've basically peeled out half of the first iteration. And in that first half, you've also checked C. And if C was false, then and once you do that loop inversion, then it becomes possible to do loop invariant code motion, because now one iteration of the loop will definitely execute once you are inside the then branch of the if. And so now it becomes possible to do loop invariant code motion. So that's an excellent point. If you recall, when we discussed loop inversion, I mentioned that this is in fact one of the first transformations that compilers do for a loop, because it enables many other transformations. And this is one of the reasons, right? Because loop invariant code motion is actually, although when we discuss loop invariant code motion, we don't talk about all these undefined behavior issues. Because at that time, we don't even talk about all these overflow and that kind of stuff. But when you actually have to develop a compiler, you know, you have to worry about all these corner cases as well. And in which case, you know, just doing loop invariant code motion may be unsafe, but if you do loop inversion, then it becomes always safe. Yes, so yeah, absolutely. Thanks for that comment.
I had another question. So all the semantics we have discussed right now, they have a runtime feel to it. So like if this was interaction, if this value was dynamically false, then you will be triggered, or this would be a poison value. So how is it done statically? I mean, how does the code generator look like? So do we do some kind of conservative analysis that this value may be poison, and then do it accordingly?
Yeah, absolutely. So when we talk about operational semantics, we are only talking about the runtime behavior, right? Just like we talk about operational semantics, you know, when we talked about operational semantics, one of the earlier lectures, one lecture module. And then we say, okay, what should happen if there was an overflow? For example, if there was int max plus one, then there would be an overflow, and so on. But now when you're doing a static analysis, you are obviously doing a conservative analysis, right? Which is that, what are all the possibilities? And then if you want to do a transformation, then you need to reason about the fact that for all those possibilities, this transformation is legal. So if you have some input argument in your function, let's say it's called x, there, and you don't know anything about x, then you have to conservatively assume that x could potentially be int max. In fact, you have to also conservatively assume that x could potentially be poison. And you have to cater to all those possibilities when you're doing your compiler optimization. And indeed, because you have to consider all these possibilities, it will constrain your transformation space. For example, the fact that you have to consider the case where X could be poison. This is something that we had never discussed earlier. We didn't even know what a poison value is before we discussed this set of modules. But now you have to cater for that case when X could have been poison. So now, for example, you couldn't, if there was a branch on X, if your code has if X, then you have to treat it carefully. You can't just hoist it, because now that would be undefined behavior and you would be hoisting undefined behavior. Does that answer your question?
Let's say there's an operation add x equals add y z, and y and z are not poison. So obviously I would have to assume that y plus z can overflow and x could be poison, right?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, if x equals y plus z is an instruction, even if you can reason about statically that y and z are definitely not poison, because y plus z, I'm assuming that you mean add nsw y z, right? I mean, if there's no nsw or nuw modifier, then it cannot be poison, then it's just wrap around. But if it is nsw or nuw in LLVM parlance, then add nsw y z can potentially create a poison value into x. And you unless you can reason about the fact that y plus z can never overflow, you have to cater for the fact that x could potentially be poison.
So obviously reasoning about that is really difficult. So potentially my every operation, every simple arithmetic operation could overflow. And so doesn't that restrict it a lot?
You're right. I mean, it's very difficult to say that something will not overflow unless you know that y is, you know, in a fixed range and z is in a small fixed range and their sums cannot go up beyond int max or something like that. Does it restrict a lot? So yeah, I mean, definitely it restricts, but the whole point of kind of designing the IR is such that the restrictions are not much. And so with using these poison value semantics, or I mean, I guess the more intuitive name here is error value semantics. So instead of error behavior, you have error value. And so, you know, if with that, you get a lot of flexibility with the error values. Error values, by the way, is a weaker form of UB because you're just saying that that value is error. It's not like the whole program has error, right? And so, and then because that only that value is error, you just say, okay, that value should not be used anymore. And so that gives that kind of, we kind of get back some flexibility back using these poison value semantics. If it was just UB, then, you know, it would have been really difficult. Using poison value, we basically get back some of the flexibility that we lost because of UB. And even there, you know, like sometimes we want that you want to disable certain types of optimization, and division is a big example of that, or dereference of a poison value is a big example of that, because if it's a dereference of a poison of an error value, then that could potentially just, you know, go and do a segmentation fault or something like that on a real hardware. So a lot of these decisions are also kind of feeding back from what's actually happening at the hardware level. So typically at the hardware level, overflow in an addition is kind of okay. I mean, it's not like it's going to crash the machine. But unsafe memory access would typically crash the program, or for a lot of architectures, or division by zero would typically crash the program for a lot of architectures. And so, you know, you basically make those choices that, okay, what do you want to allow and what you do not want to allow, and that kind of stuff. I should say that this is a really complex problem, and you have rightly hit the nail on the head, that isn't it restricting a lot of the flexibility, and isn't it, I mean, more importantly, like, isn't it completely non-intuitive? Because so far, all through the course, we have just been assuming, oh, this is, I mean, these are just mathematical equivalences that you just kind of take for granted, and nobody even questions these things. But now suddenly, like, all these kind of corner cases just make all these simple mathematical, so-called axioms false, right? For example, you can't hoist, or you can't, and we're going to see more when we talk about undefined values and stuff. And so what, you know, you'll be surprised to know that LLVM has bugs today of this kind, in the sense that, for example, by the discussion that we had in this set of modules, loop unswitching is an illegal transformation unless we can definitely be sure that the if condition cannot be poisoned. Now, figuring out whether the if condition cannot be poisoned may require a much more global analysis, and it may not be even possible to do that. And that would really restrict loop unswitching. On the other hand, loop unswitching is such a profitable optimization because you're basically getting rid of the branch inside the loop. And so what do compilers do today? You'll be surprised to know that compilers, even like LLVM framework, actually implement loop unswitching even when they are not sure that the branch condition is poison or not. Now you may wonder, why is, like, then does that mean that a compiler has a bug, and does that mean that we are going to get a wrong output from our compiler? And the answer actually is that even though you look at this narrow transformation that, okay, it does loops unswitching And semantically speaking, if it was a poison value, then this triggers UB and everything is going to go wrong. But then if you look at, if you kind of just widen your window and see what happens all the way till code generation, then it turns out that if that poison value just kind of, you know, behaves like a regular value, and that if then else whatever the code gets generated in the assembly program is just looks like a regular if then else. It doesn't actually cause UB. So the backend after this transformation, after this loop unswitching transformation, the code generation part of it doesn't really expose this possibility of UB through doing something dangerous. It does something which was kind of very expected. And so these are called, even though, you know, these are bugs inside LLVM, thankfully, they don't cause end-to-end bugs. Or they don't cause end-to-end miscompilations. Does that make sense? Loop unswitching, as such, seems illegal because of the semantics that we discussed. But if I just expand it all the way to assembly, then if I look at the entire transformation pipeline from the original program till the assembly, then it seems like, oh, the program wasn't actually, whatever you got at the assembly level actually matches with what I had originally. Because everything after that didn't exploit the UB. It just generated the same if-then-else code that would have been generated in the normal scenario when the condition wouldn't have been poisoned. And so even though just looking at this part is basically looking like it's causing an error, if you look at the whole pipeline all the way till assembly, then you find that, oh, it's not going to cause an error. So that's the state of affairs, by the way, today. Okay, that there are transformations that that do not satisfy the semantics, the formal semantics of these opcodes and values. Yet they are present because developers argue, oh, so what? I mean, they are not causing end-to-end miscompilations. But this is obviously a very contentious issue, very debatable issue, because, you know, the formal methods guy, the formal people who like correctness will say, oh, but, you know, once you do that, then somebody later down the line can now start exploiting the UB and you will never know. And now you will start getting, from a software engineering point of view, it becomes a nightmare now to figure out that the end-to-end miscompilation can never happen, because now you have done this loop unswitching. And now somebody down the line can say, oh, I can just exploit the UB to do yet another transformation. And now there becomes a possibility. And these two things are completely disconnected. So when somebody is code reviewing the later part of code generation, he or she will never think, oh, by the way, this can happen. And so this is a huge software engineering nightmare. Many formal method researchers are trying to convince the LLVM developers. So it's also basically this thing about, you know, things should be totally well-defined formally speaking. Like the semantics should be formally defined. And that's where all these poison value semantics. In fact, for a long time, GCC and LLVM didn't even have formal semantics for all these corner cases. It is only in the last few, maybe 10 years or so, 10 plus years, that these formal semantics have been proposed and now being finalized. And so for all this time, like, you know, people are just at a semantic level, we are not sure that whether things are actually going to work or not. They just happen to work. We just do a lot of testing and this happen to work. And that's a very scary kind of thing, is imagining that a compiler actually goes into things that go into our flight controllers or our self-driving cars and things like that. I mean, that's a very scary thought. So that's why people are saying, okay, we need to have formal methods. But when you have formal methods, then developers kind of push back and say, oh, why do I need all these formal methods? Like I implemented all these fancy optimizations. They make code so much faster. I cannot see any end-to-end miscompilations. Why do I need these semantics? And even if I need semantics, please give me some better semantics. These are too restrictive. And so this kind of constant tussle goes on between the developers, and slowly, like, people are coming up with new ideas. Either we have to come up with fresh ideas on how semantics should be proposed, or we have to just convince the developers to give in and say, okay, you know, we are going to thwart some optimizations. Those are the only two answers here. And I guess this is still work in progress. अर्पित
सेंड द स्क्रीनशॉट. सो लाइक इन दिस लेफ्ट पार्ट, सो बेसिकली आई वाज कंफ्यूज्ड दैट व्हाट आर द वैल्यूज दैट फाई नोड इज टेकिंग. सो बेसिकली इज इट लाइक द वाई दैट नेवर वेंट इनटू इफ एंड द वाई दैट वेंट इनटू इफ, और इज इट समथिंग एल्स?
Yeah, I mean, actually, you know, it may be a little confusing the way I have done the slide. The slide is basically the slide which says if c y equals x plus 1 and then z equals phi into something. So, yeah, this dot 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 can be anything. It can be completely unrelated to y, actually.
Because I was thinking that if it was y, then in the right program, then if x plus 1 was poison,
the
then y2
to say that dot 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 cannot be y, right? Because given that it's SSA, y can only be defined once in the whole program, and if it's being defined on the if branch, then it won't be even present on the else in the other branch, else branch.
Okay.
That dot 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 typically be something that's other than y.
Okay, I understand. So, I have one more thing to ask. So, I was curious, so that based on thing that we saw, so is that what they call pointer provenance? So, is that related to it? Or?
Yes, I think so. Pointer provenance, I think that's what pointer provenance is. Sounds like
okay. Can you repeat, because you're not audible to me. I guess my internet is a bit weird.
I'm saying that yes, indeed, pointer provenance is probably the same thing as phase path analysis that I I think people talk about. So first of all, I'm not sure, because pointer provenance is a larger term. Can you hear? Maybe you want to mute. I hear a lot of noise.
Yeah, okay.
So I'm saying that pointer provenance is basically is a more umbrella term that is used for different languages and things like that. And I'm not 100% sure that it's exactly the same thing as based on or not, but it seems like it should be the same thing by the just going by the name pointer provenance. But yeah, I mean, the C language, I mean, if I just talk about the C language, they have something called a based on semantics, and that's what their C standard says. And the based on semantics basically says that, you know, something was derived from this this pointer, so then it should be based on that pointer. And then I can kind of keep doing arithmetic on it, and I would still be based on that particular object address and so on. Yes, so I guess that's the same thing as pointer provenance. Yeah, but I think I you know, you need to check for yourself what is the exact meaning of pointer provenance.
Okay.
Thanks. Okay, Jay.
So as we discussed undefined behavior, so there were two other things that you previously brought up in the previous courses as well. So one was implementation defined behavior, and one was unspecified behavior. So how do they come into play? I mean,
Yeah, thanks for that question. So indeed, so first of all, non-determinism in programming language semantics is typically introduced for either portability, which means that the same program can be kind of compiled for different architectures, or performance, which is optimization opportunity, as we saw in the set of modules, or there's a third term called performance portability. Performance portability means that you can have good performance on all architectures, Right. So I'll give you an example. So let's say there is an instruction called shift. Let's say shift left. Right. So so now on some architectures, if you so let's say there's a 32-bit integer and you shift it left by 32 bits. Let's say you should try to shift it left by 33 bits. Now on x86, shifting by left by 33 bits is just going to give you a zero, let's say. And on PowerPC, shifting left by 32 bits is, let's say, going to rotate the values, or it's going to be a no op, let's say. So now on now as a C designer, I provide the left shift operator, which is the less than operator, and I want to define semantics for the less than operator. So what are the semantics that I should define? If I choose the fact that, okay, if you left shift by 33 bits, a 32 bit integer, then you get zero, then that basically means I have to pay the extra cost of emulating those semantics in PowerPC, because now the left shift operator on PowerPC will need to be implemented using more than one instruction, maybe 5-6 instructions, because, you know, to cater for all possible cases, for example, half of it has shifted or things like that. I'll have to basically make sure that things are do, and it makes the program slower on PowerPC. On the other hand, the other option the C designers could have taken is that if you do this, then it rotates all the time. Then on x86, I'll have to emit multiple instructions to implement the. So if I take either of the two choices, then that doesn't. The program is still portable in the sense it's possible to generate code for both architectures, but it's not performance portable. I cannot get good performance on both architectures. I can get good performance on one architecture and not on the other, or vice versa. So performance portability. So now the C designers, one of the things they need to worry about is performance portability. And so what they did was they said, okay, if you shift greater than the bit width of the integer, then that's undefined behavior. Okay, now that's what they chose, and that gives you performance portability, because now if you do that, then that should not happen, first of all, and if it happens, then I can do whatever I like, and depending on the architecture, I will choose which one it is. Now the other option that the C designers could have used was implementation defined behavior. Implementation defined behavior basically says, undefined behavior says that anything can happen. For example, I can even delete all the files in your system. Implementation defined behavior says, here are the 5-6 options that are possible for you, depending on the implementation. And those options are basically dependent only on the implementation environment and nothing else. It cannot be that undefined behavior says, you know, the first time you in the first iteration, maybe I choose to do X, on the second iteration, I choose to do Y. I'm completely okay to do that, right? But implementation defined behavior says, whatever is the implementation, based on that, you chose a behavior, and now that behavior remains fixed for the entire duration of the execution. Okay, so it limits the non-determinism to some small number of fixed values, and those behaviors need to be chosen upfront depending on what is the implementation I'm running on. So that's implementation defined behavior. Then there's unspecified behavior. So unspecified behavior, a famous example of unspecified behavior is the order of evaluation in C. So if you say X equals Y plus Z, and where Z could be an expression and Y could be an expression, then I could first evaluate Y, then evaluate Z, and then do plus. Or I could first evaluate Z, then evaluate Y, then do plus. Or in fact, I could evaluate Y and Z in parallel if I have a parallel machine or something like that. All these three are possible options. And this is a famous example of unspecified behavior in C. This is distinct from undefined behavior, firstly, because the number of options is limited. You can either do this first and then that, or this first and then that, or you can do those things in parallel. But it's not like anything can happen. It's not like undefined behavior. There's a fixed number of limited choices. It's also different from implementation defined behavior, because those choices can be different on every execution. It doesn't have to be fixed to the implementation environment. You know, so that's unspecified behavior.
Okay, thank you.
And why did the C designers decide to have all these different kinds of non-determinism? Firstly, non-determinism is Non-determinism in the source language is good for performance portability and performance portability. And so it's a great idea to have as much non-determinism as possible from all these three perspectives in the language. But non-determinism is a bad idea from a programmability perspective, because now, I mean, how many of you were aware that, you know, signed integer overflow is undefined behavior? And most of us, most of, like 99, I mean, maybe I don't want to put in the figure, but large fraction, an overwhelmingly large fraction of developers don't even know that these are these kind of corner cases and they're still programming. In fact, there are many production software that you'll find which basically rely on a particular choice that a compiler is making. So they would basically say, oh, I know that that GCC 4.8 makes this particular choice. And they would test with GCC 4.8 and they would happily ship the program. Tomorrow, new GCC gets updated or they decide to change the compiler and suddenly the program shows a different behavior and maybe it's a bug or something and now they are wondering why it is. The problem is not the other kind of common misconception, oh, there was a compiler bug. That's why my program got, how can the program behave differently if I just change the compiler? The answer is because your program had undefined behavior and you were relying on the compiler behavior for a specific choice. And that was giving you a certain behavior. And now the compiler has changed its choice and now you're getting a different behavior. And so the bug is in your program, not in the compiler. Okay. So this is a programmability challenge. And by the other thing, so by the way, what are the responses of typical kind of organizations? Of course, things are improving over time, significantly improving over time. But let's say, you know, even now, I would say, and at least 10 years ago, I was 100%, like I've seen cases where people would either keep sticking to a certain compiler, really old version of a compiler, because they are just too scared to upgrade to a new version because they know that their code will just break. And so that means that they're living with old optimizations, old set of features and everything for a long, long time. Or they would just turn off optimization. They'll just say, I'm going to ship code without any optimizations because they know that optimizations are just going to expose bugs in their code. So those are kind of responses that, you know, people have lived with. So what is this whole set of problems can be called the problems of programmability. Because people don't understand these corner case semantics, they can't reason about the program in a totally kind of bulletproof way. They resort to hacks and that causes programmability issues. And that's one reason that, you know, languages like Java and Python decided against having non-determinism as much as possible so that you kind of give predictable behavior as much as possible. So there's this trade-off between programmability and performance, portability and stuff like that. And so some languages will do more non-determinism, some will do less non-determinism. C is by far, and there are niches for each of them. So C is a great language if you really care about performance portability. And so there's a niche for that, and that's why C is popular in those spaces like embedded systems, performance critical stuff, and so on. And then there's a niche for Java and Python where, you know, it's all about ease of programming. I really don't care about, you know, getting the last drop of performance out of my machine. So yes, I mean, so and consequently, you will find that all these kind of, and so the C designers have really put a lot of thought into what kind of undefined behavior should, what kind of non-determinism they want. And they've come up with all these different types of non-determinism, unspecified, implementation defined, undefined, and so on, because, you know, they, even C designers want to kind of balance programmability with the performance, not like they just want to kind of throw away programmability altogether. So yeah, that's it. I also want to point out that C++, by the way, is less non-deterministic than C. Okay, so I mean, people think that C++ and C should be almost the same, but C++ designers have consciously chosen to have less non-determinism than C. So, that's how the world is evolving, I guess. Yeah. Okay.
Should that mean we should write compilers in languages without non-determinism?
Does that mean that we should write compilers in languages without non-determinism or with non-determinism? Does it, could you repeat your question? I mean, does it mean that compilers should be written in language?
Well, compilers should not have that non-deterministic behavior, right? Well, that can cause bugs that are very subtle to code.
Yeah, I mean, see, first of all, I want to point out that it doesn't matter which language you write your program in, as long as you are able to, you understand what the language semantics are, and then you write your program such that against those language semantics. You shouldn't write your program against a particular compiler semantic. So people say, well, in GCC, this is what happens, so that's why I'm going to do this. Then, of course, it's not going to work with GCC upgrade. But if you're writing your program against a compiler, against a language semantics, then you'll always be able to write any program you'd like. These are all Turing complete languages. You can write any program you like in C, you can write any program you like in Java, and so on. By the way, what are typical compilers written in? Which languages are typical compilers written in? Any answers?
C++
and even C, in fact, right? Why are compilers written in C and C++? That kind of runs contrary to the question just asked, right? I mean, why are compilers written in C?
Performance.
Performance, basically. Compilers are compute intensive pieces of software, and we want to draw, you know, there's a lot of work that just goes into improving the compile time. And if I kind of implement a compiler in a high-level language like Python and Java, I'm already paying a huge cost just for that. So it'll be easier to write a compiler in Python or Java, but those compilers don't become popular because, you know, somebody comes up and writes a program in C and C++ and they're going to be have much faster discharge of compilations, and everybody moves to that. Right, so performance matters. Anywhere performance matters, you would want to kind of. What does that mean if compilers have to be are being written in unsafe languages, or I should say non-deterministic languages? Programmers just need to be sure that, you know, the inputs are, you know, it, the UB can never be triggered. It's the programmer's responsibility to ensure in these unsafe languages. I'm using the word unsafe in quote unquote. In these unsafe languages like C and C++, it's the onus is on the programmer to ensure that no UB occurs. In safe languages like Java and Python, the runtime also helps you out a little bit and tells you, you know, your program has a problem or something like that. In C, C++, the runtime doesn't help you out at all. It just says, okay, you're on your own. If you make a mistake, too bad, right? So what are operating systems written in? C, C++, right? Typically C, in fact. So why? Because once again, performance. The other reason is because there's a certain class of programmers that are comfortable with that degree of non-determinism and that degree of complexity and that level of reasoning. And they say, okay, I can reason about this and I care about performance. So operating systems and compiler developers are typically folks that are okay with that kind of complexity. But if you want to do some higher level programming, like, I'm just picking on, let's say, data analytics or something, then maybe, you know, you don't care about, you know, you're not like, you're not that low level programmer, and then you would want to have a higher level. So it's also a social issue or who is comfortable with what and kind of thing. And so that's another kind of reason why different languages get picked for different things. But to answer your question, compilers can be written in any language. They're typically written in performance critical languages.